Yeah, welcome to our next session in the lecture Numerical Methods for Mathematical Finance. And we already had one session on computer arithmetic, where we looked actually into how numbers are represented in the computer, especially the floating point numbers. So with the normalized and denormalized floating point numbers, discretizing the set of real numbers. And today I like to talk a little bit about having arithmetic operations on these numbers. So the input are two floating point numbers, and then we have some function applied to this. Okay, and so we discuss the implementation according to this IEEE 754 standard. And this standard defines something which is called exact rounding of the result. So what does this mean? Assume you have floating point numbers here, and maybe also here. Yeah, so maybe here they are a little bit finer. Yeah, you know that we have this effect that the further we go away from zero, the absolute distance is increasing, but the relative distance is more or less constant. And then I have maybe two arguments here, say X and Y. Okay, these dots. And then I have a mathematical function, G of X and Y. Okay, so this is my Z. And the result is some number, maybe here. But we cannot expect that this is part of our set. Yeah? So what happens to the result in the computer? Yeah? So there is some implementation, say I call the implementation being G tilde, which gives me a different result, and this result is now in the set of floating point numbers. So this is what I like to discuss with you today. And the standard, the IEEE standard here, has exact rounding. So it guarantees that the result of an operation is rounded to the nearest representation in the set. So to the nearest representation in the set. Here in our example, this would mean that this mathematical result, which is the set, is rounded to this floating point number, which is then the set tilde. Okay. So you can somewhat rely on that there's no other rounding error inside the implementation of G tilde if this function is providing exact rounding. Yeah, so for example, if G is the exponential function, you know that you can approximate G with a Taylor sequence. Yeah, so 1 plus x squared half and so on. And this approximation would have an error. So if they tell you the exponential function is implemented according to the standard with exact rounding, they tell you that the approximation they use inside does not produce an error larger than that you would get already from the rounding to the next representation. Okay, so but we have to define the rounding. So let's define the set F. So the set F is my set of floating point numbers. So this set consists of the normalized floating point numbers. So this was what we looked at first. Okay, so these are the normalized floating point numbers. And the denormalized floating point numbers, which then contain this set around zero. Okay, and sorry. The denormalized floating point numbers, which is some discretization around zero. Okay, and you know that the normalized floating point numbers, actually they are in between an interval where the largest possible normalized floating point number was, okay, so this is now the positive one. So it was 1 plus the largest value for C was 2 to the power of P minus 1 divided by 2 to the power of P. Yeah, so that was here the largest value for the C. So actually, so this was a number between 1 included and 2 not included. And then it was the largest exponent here in this factor, which is modifying the scale of the interval, was Emax minus 1. So actually, the next number you would think of is C goes 1 point further. So this is a 2 multiplied with 2 to the power of Emax minus 1. So this is something like 2 to the power of Emax. Okay. And this is actually internally the representation of the infinity. Yeah. So infinity is a little bit like 2 to the power of Emax. Yeah. So recall, infinity is encoded as S is zero, it's the positive infinity, Z is zero, and E is equal to Emax. So actually it looks a little bit like infinity is just a number. Okay, and this is also my interpretation of this set here. Yeah? So this is a set of numbers where I interpret infinity, the two infinities on the left and the right side, as being numbers. Okay, so now I have a set of numbers. So if you like to draw the set, you have a line here. Okay, so where you have the denormalized numbers around zero, there's zero here. Okay, then you have the first normalized numbers, which are 2 to the power of e min, right? No, e min plus 1. Yeah, because 2 to the power of e min are the denormalized ones. And here's minus 2 to the power of e min. Then you have intervals, which become larger and larger on both sides. Okay. In between, you have discretization using our value c. Okay. At some point here, far out, there is an interval, say, from here to here, and this is, how do I do it? This is 2 to the power of e max minus 1, and then we can use the c to discretize this interval. And then there would be the next number here, and this is infinity. Okay, so the same on the left hand side, if you like. So some number here, 1, 2, 3. Yeah. So it's not so proportional here, and there is the number called minus infinity, which sits here. Okay, so, and now I defined the operation of rounding any number in the real, in the set of real numbers to this set. Okay, so, and this operation is take the nearest representation. Okay, so this means that, for example, if you have some number, say, here, it's rounded to this number. Okay, but it also means that if you have some number beyond infinity, it's rounded to this number, which is infinity. And it also means that if you have something in between the last normalized number and this special number infinity, it's rounded to infinity. Okay, so maybe to complete the drawing, there are also here the denormalized ones. Yeah, so drawing is not so proportional here, but I believe you now get the idea of this set. Yeah, so this is a set containing the normalized numbers, the denormalized numbers, and it also contains the two special values, minus and plus infinity. And I'm considering these values as just numbers, and I can round these numbers. I will discuss this with you, or we have a small experiment on this later. So just one remark here. So maybe you already realized that this definition, yeah, is not sufficient to actually know how float of x is defined, because I don't say anything about what happens if there's a point exactly in between. Yeah. So for some x exactly in between. Two adjacent x tilde 1, x tilde 2 in our set F, we still have to define to which one we round. Yeah? And there are different strategies. Different definitions. For float. So see, for example, the literature which I cite on computer arithmetic. So maybe, for example, you think, okay, I know what I should do. I always round to the smallest number. Yeah? Or you would say to the number closer to zero. Yeah? So you round to the smallest numbers for the positive and to the largest number for the negative, something like this. But actually, it appears as if this is a small corner case, yeah? So that it's a rare event. But you can find that a computer algorithm creates a bias if he does this. So if you always take the smaller number, if you are in between, this creates a bias, and this bias can lead to an issue in your program. So there are, for example, different strategies like going through all the floating point numbers and alternating, so either I round down or I round up, yeah? So and it switches in between. So if I round up or down depends on where I am on this line. Okay, but this is maybe a detail, yeah? But you see that the things are really, they are nice little issues on a very low level. And let's keep it like this. We round to the next representation in the set, and that's maybe enough for our discussion. Okay, so what does this mean for the arithmetic operation? I already mentioned this in the introduction. So if we have some arguments in our set of floating point numbers, and we have a mathematical function g, which is well defined. So this g is here the mathematical function. So like, take the square root, take the exponential. Then the implementation which I call g tilde satisfies the property that the result of g tilde, which has to be in F, yeah, it is an implementation, and g tilde maps something onto the set F, this has the property that it's guaranteed that it is the next representation in the set F, yeah? So the nearest floating point number to the exact result. Okay, so this means that if we have a function like exponential and they tell us this function is implemented with exact rounding, then we are sure that the result does not have a rounding error larger than that which we get from rounding the result to the floating point numbers. So, but however, what you have to be aware of, if you write a computer program that has multiple steps, For example, you like to take the exponential of x squared, then there is some kind of error propagation because each individual operation has maybe exact rounding, but it has a rounding error. So the combination of these may have a rounding error which is different. We have an example today. So, but our code may produce rounding errors which are larger than that which you get from rounding to the next representation, because we are combining the arithmetic operations g tilde, h tilde, and whatever. So we are not combining g and h. Yeah? So we are not combining the mathematical functions, we are combining implementations. Okay, so here I said x1 and up to xn in f are assumed, so we assume these and the result should be well defined. There is another value which is which can be represented by the floating point encoding. Yeah, so this value is not a number, which is some error value. So that can also be an input. And what happens if you have infinity or not a number as arguments actually depends on the implementation, and you should read the documentation of the implementation, what happens when you have not a number or infinity as arguments. Okay, oh, maybe we should have a small computer experiment on this. So maybe explore what happens if we play a little bit around with these special values. So let's have a code session here. So I switch to my Eclipse, and this is the code which we created in the previous session, where we had an experiment on integer, and we also had a first experiment on the floating point numbers. Okay, I just added a few comments, yeah, and what we did last was looking at this smallest positive number for which 1 plus x and 1 is equal, but 1 plus 2x is not equal to 1. Okay, so if I run this program, we have this output here. Maybe you remember it from the last session. And I just like to continue at this point. Okay, so I like to continue at this point. So let's have a comment here, and we do some small experiments with special values, say like infinity and not a number. Okay, so let's try these. So I like to have some title in my output. So let's create a title. Let's use the comment here as a title. And an extra new line. So, yeah, what could we do? What actually is 1 divided by 0? Yeah. So what does he do? Is this an error, 1 divided by 0? Is it not a number, or is it some value? So let's define 0. And let's define 1 over 0, which is 1.0 divided by 0. Okay, so let's print this. So do you have a guess what it is? You can write it in the chat if you like. Actually, when I have Eclipse open, I don't see the chat, but can I change this? Maybe I can change this. Oh, yeah, okay, I can change it. So now I see the chat. So 1 divided by 0 is equal, let's do it like this, is equal to 1 over 0. Okay, so 1 divided by 0 is infinity. Okay, so it's the special value infinity. This is nice. In the representation of the numbers, maybe you remember that we had a plus and a minus 0. So recall, there exist a plus 0 and a minus 0. Yeah, so it's minus 1 to the power of s times c divided by 2p times 2e min plus 1. These were the denormalized numbers. Yeah? And this guy is encoded with s equals 0, c equals 0, and this guy is encoded with s equals 1 and z equals 0. Can I create plus and minus 0? Okay, so let's try to create 0 in a different way. I initialize the variable plus 0 by 1, and then I make it smaller and smaller by dividing by 2. So as long as plus 0 is larger than 0, make it smaller. Okay, and then maybe I like to print this number. So actually, as a mathematician, I would say this loop runs forever. I had this example yesterday. Okay, but maybe you already know that it doesn't run forever. Okay, because at a certain point, the result will be rounded to 0. Actually, it could also run forever, but it does not. Okay, so plus 0 is 0. Okay, and we are converging to 0 from the right. So we are converging to 0 from the right. Maybe a small remark. This here is a bad code style. Yeah? Because actually you initialize this value to something which is also which is not the right value if you look at this name. And then we modify this value. Okay. So but for this demo it's maybe okay. But if somebody reads this code, he might frown at this point here. Yeah. And it's a much better code style to work with variables which do not modify their meaning during the algorithm. But for such a small algorithm, this is perfectly okay. So if you do something like this, you should keep it in a small location. Yeah. So variables should not change their meaning over large areas of your code. Okay, so that was just a small remark. Let's do the same. Okay, I copy it here with minus 0 by creating convergence from the left, yeah, from the negative numbers. So while minus 0 is smaller than 0, I make it closer to 0 by dividing by 2. So what do we get if we do convergence from the left? Okay, so you see there is a difference between plus and minus zero. He can distinguish it because he is actually printing. He's printing this out. Okay, so now I have created two different values. Actually, I have three values because I have explicitly created the zero here. I have explicitly created the zero. I have constructed plus zero by convergence, and I have constructed minus zero also by convergence. Okay, so are they equal? Let's print if they are equal. So checking if something is equal, equal. Yeah? So this is the comparison operator. And this is what I like to see. Is plus zero equal to minus zero? Okay, so what do we get? Yes, it's true. Okay, so he has two different numbers representing the same mathematical object, namely zero. So he has two different floating point numbers representing the same mathematical object in different encodings. So if they are equal, do they behave differently? Okay, so let's repeat what we did here. Yeah, one divided by zero for these two different numbers. Okay, you already maybe guess what we get. So one divided by plus zero. What do we get if we do this? One divided by plus zero. And one divided by minus zero should also be printed. Okay, so let's run our little program and you see we get plus infinity and minus infinity. Okay, which is very reasonable. Yeah. So they behave differently. And sometimes this is quite helpful. Yeah. So, okay, so now we have created infinity and minus infinity. So let's give them a name. Plus infinity is 1 divided by plus 0, and minus infinity is 1 divided by minus 0. Okay, so if plus 0 and minus 0 is equal, and 1 divided by one of these is plus or minus infinity. Actually, what is plus infinity? Plus minus infinity. So plus infinity plus minus infinity. So what's that? So if you look back to our slide with this line here, actually it looks as if we interpret plus and minus infinity as numbers, they are the same numbers in absolute value, just with a different sign. Okay, so plus infinity plus minus infinity is not a number. Okay. So we get some error code. Yeah. So actually plus infinity and minus infinity behave different from other numbers. We have, so with respect to the rounding, they behave like a number, but once you are there, operations behave different. So maybe I have another remark here. We have plus infinity plus minus infinity is equal not a number. And this is maybe reasonable because if you see that if you have plus and minus infinity sitting here on the line, actually, if the result of some operation, say, which sits here, is rounded to plus infinity, so this is rounding, or you have maybe a result sitting here, which is also rounded to infinity, then the difference of the orange dots, so of the two orange results, or the sum, yeah? So the sum of the two orange results can have an arbitrary value, yeah? Because you can push the orange point further and further to the right. So maybe I give them two different colors, yeah? So this is here brown, and then we have orange. Okay, so I can push the orange point further and further to the right, yeah, make it larger and larger, and the true value of the sum would become larger and larger, but the sum of the rounded results doesn't see this. So we would have an infinite, unbounded rounding error if we would say that plus infinity plus minus infinity is, for example, zero. Yeah? And that's a good reason to put it to not a number. So we cannot say anything about what is going on if we have two results which are plus and minus infinity and we take a sum of them. Okay, so we get not a number. So actually you can also create dot not a number by asking the double class for NRN. Okay, so you can move the mouse here and you see a constant holding a not a number value. Yeah, so they even call it here value. So it's equivalent to the value returned by, and then you see the representation in the binary form, which actually corresponds to what we had on our slide. Okay, so I can create this not a number. So let's look how he's printing this. So not a number, no, print this. Or maybe something like this. Okay, so he's printing it as NaN. Okay, so what happens if we do something that is not a real number? say, for example, square root of minus one. Okay, so square root of minus one. We also get not a number, so it's an error. So what happens if we add something to not a number? It just says not a number. So once you have an error or a not a number in your calculation, this will propagate. Yeah? So it will ensure that the final result is not a number, and you see that there is an error. Something similar is true for infinity. Yeah? So what happens if you add some other number to infinity, say 1 plus infinity? What is 1 plus infinity? It's infinity. Okay. So maybe that was enough on these special values, infinity and not a number. But you see they have some reasonable behavior. For example, 1 divided by plus 0 is infinity, 1 divided by minus 0 is minus infinity. Okay, so here I have a small exercise, and we already maybe worked a little bit on this. Yeah, the machine precision. So show that our rounding error for the normalized floating point numbers here. Yeah, so these are the positive ones. Actually, I could have could add here the absolute value. Yeah, so it is also true for the negative ones. The rounding error is equal is equal to some constant times x. Yeah. So this means the relative error which we get from rounding. So I'm doing rounding on some number, compare it to the number, divide by the magnitude of the number. This is equal some constant, which is smaller or equal 2 to the minus p plus 1. So actually, what was this p? So recall, these are the normalized floating point numbers. So these were minus 1 to the power of s, which is the sine, 1 plus c divided by 2p times 2 to the power of e. And c was in between zero and 2 to the power of p, so that what you have in the bracket is between 1 included and 2 not included. Okay, so you see the distance between two different values of c is 1 divided by 2 to the power of p, multiplied with 2 to the power of e. But if we look at the relative distance, the 2 to the power of e, the exponent, yeah, is canceling, and the difference is just 1 divided by 2 to the power of p. So the size of the interval, or the distance between two such numbers, is 1 divided by 2p times 2 to the power of e. So the relative, distance between two such numbers is approximately 1 divided by 2p. So now, since I'm rounding to the next number, if I'm in between, I have another reduction of 1/2, because if I'm in between, the largest possible distance is 1/2 of the interval to the largest possible distance to the next number. So we get a maximum relative error of 1 divided by 2p plus 1. Okay, so, and what was actually the p? The p was the number of bits we use for the mantissa and for double. P was chosen to be 52. Yeah, so we had 52 bits used for this out of the 64 bits we use. 11 bits were used for the exponent e, and 1 bit was used for the sign. Okay, so actually we worked a little bit on this, finding this number here. So this number, I give it a name, is called epsilon. I can just use the symbol epsilon. And we already constructed epsilon yesterday, and I just want to look again at the code. Yeah? So this was done in our other session. So actually, we were constructing a number epsilon such that 1 plus x epsilon is, and now we can reinterpret this, 1 plus epsilon is rounded to 1. Yeah, so make epsilon smaller as long as 1 plus epsilon is not rounded to 1, so it is different from 1. If 1 plus epsilon is equal to 1, then we stop. Okay, so we ran this little program in another session, and let's review the results. Yeah, so what is this epsilon? This epsilon is 1 times 10 to the minus 16. 1 plus epsilon is 1. So 1 plus epsilon is an arithmetic operation, and the result of this arithmetic operation is rounded to 1. So 1 plus epsilon is equal to 1. Yes, we can check it. It's true. But epsilon is not 0. If we multiply epsilon with 2, so we multiply epsilon with 2, and we add this result to 1, then we get something which is different from 1. Okay, so we have found a number epsilon which is small. Among those smallest number, it's the largest number, and it is the number which cannot be distinguished from 1 if we add it to 1. So such that 1 plus epsilon cannot be distinguished from 1. So, but now we can rephrase this, since we know rounding, that this is rounding to 1. What happened? What is happening here is rounding to 1. Here I wrote that actually this epsilon is 2 to the power of minus p plus 1. So actually, since p for the floating point doubles is 52, this number here, epsilon, actually it should be 2 to the power of minus 53. Let's check this, okay? So let's print what is actually 2 to the power of minus 53. Okay, so what's that? So we have the math package or class, and there is the power function, and we take 2 and a minus 53. Yeah? And I would like to print this. Oops, I have an error. So, okay, and here's the result. So this is our result here. And you see, yes, this number epsilon, which we constructed here, is exactly what we have on our slide. It's 2 to the power of minus p plus 1. Yeah? It's the machine precision. Okay, so this epsilon here is the machine precision, or the precision of the normalized floating point numbers in double precision. Okay, so I added something to our exercise here. And let's continue. With the lecture. Okay, so I can maybe be a little bit quicker here. So we have rounding to infinity. Yeah, the numbers minus infinity and plus infinity are just numbers, namely these two special value, and there is something called rounding to infinity. So I already have drawn this. Yeah, if you have some input of an operation, say you have here x and y, and there is the true mathematical result z is g of x and y, yeah, then if our z tilde is the floating point representation of z, yeah, so actually this is the rounding of of z, but this is then the result of our implementation g tilde of x and y. Yeah? So this here is then the z tilde. If z was larger, well, than this special number, 2e max. Yeah? So, which is what we have if we have the infinity interpreted as a number. Okay, so we have some rounding to infinity. Actually, I already told you that rounding to infinity can also happen if you are too close to infinity from the left-hand side. Okay, let's have a little experiment with this. I like to be a little bit quicker maybe. So what's this number here? the red one. It's the largest normalized floating point number. So this number, let's call it max double, I can get it if I ask max value. Yeah? So max value is the largest normalized floating point number. So let's print this number. What is the number? I always hit the end. So, okay. It's 1.7 times 10 to the power of 308. This 308 is 2 to the power of 1023, something 24 approximately. Okay, so what happens if I do and add a little bit to max double? Say max double plus 1000. Okay, so or 100, I don't care. So let's use 1000. Then the result is rounded back to this large number. Yeah. Let's add something more larger to it. Let's take max double plus max double. So if I add something very large to it, I'm rounded to infinity. Okay. I'm rounded to infinity. So let's subtract max double again. I stay in infinity, okay? So infinity is a little bit like a magnet. Once you are there, you don't get out, okay? So, but if you do a bracket around this, so first I take the difference of the two max doubles and then I add it to max double. I get max double again. Okay, you see that here again, fundamental mathematical laws are violated, but actually we now know that it's reasonable because we hit it infinity once, and once you have hit it infinity, we could have a rounding error that is infinite large, and he is not letting us out again. Okay, so that was a little experiment on the largest possible value and the rounding to infinity. So now it becomes even more interesting, loss of significance. So we constructed epsilon such that 1 plus epsilon is rounded to 1. Yeah? So actually, 1 plus epsilon is equal to 1. So this may lead to very strange result. And now I have an example which is more from the mathematical side. So here you see again the code that we use to construct this. Yeah? So this is called the machine precision. I can skip this. And I would like to do the following exercise. Calculate the smallest solution of x squared minus px plus q equals 0 for p very large. So this is 10 million, I believe. And q being 1. Okay, so maybe you know that the solution of this quadratic equation x squared minus 2px plus q is actually it's minus the coefficient in front of x half. So since this is already minus 2p, it's now p. And then it's plus or minus the square root of this, of the square of this guy, p squared minus q. Okay, so maybe you know this from school. So, and then the smallest solution is x1p minus square root of p square minus q. Okay, so you know this. Okay, so let's try what's happening, what this is. Okay, so what was p? P was 10 million. So let's create p equals 10 million. 10 to 3, 1 to 3. Q was 1. So now solve the equation. So solve x squared minus 2px plus q equals 0. Since we know what the solution is, it is p minus the square root of p squared p times p minus q. Okay, so then let's check if this is the solution. So let's call this error, yeah, because if it is the solution, this number should be 0. So what is x squared minus 2px plus q? Okay, so let's print. So I'm printing. So you will get this code, yeah? I'm writing quite fast here. I'm checking this in, yeah, this is in our Git repository. So I print the solution and I print the error. Sorry, the error. So this is the error. So now I print the error. Okay. We get some number, yeah. It's small, but it looks like it could be the solution. And if you plug this in, I get a number which is comparably large and which is not zero. So actually, this is a bit strange. Okay, so what happened here? So the issue is actually that P is quite large, okay? And we are using the minus sign, okay? This number is large. And Q compared to P is small. So I know that this square root is approximately P. It's not exactly P. And it's also large. The solution, as you see, is a rather small number. And this small number is the difference of two large numbers. So what's happening is that here we have the zero. Here you have a fine discretization of numbers. And here on the outside, you have a large discretization of numbers. Okay. And maybe one of your numbers, say the P, oh, actually the P is the P is a floating point number. So it is here. So this is our P. And maybe the result of P squared minus Q is just a small difference from that. It's just a small difference from that. Maybe it's here. P squared minus Q square root. Okay. And then he is actually rounding this. So this here is our 2 epsilon. Yeah, in relative terms. Yeah, so 2 epsilon times P. So let's write it in absolute terms, so that's correct. 2 epsilon times P is the size of this interval. So we have a quite large error on this scale. And then we are taking the minus and pop in this region. And this region has very small rounding errors, but the rounding error, which was part of the previous operation, is much larger. Okay. You see on the slide that actually there is an alternative. Okay, so if you have P minus square root of P square minus Q, okay, then you can multiply this with P plus square root of P square minus Q divided by P plus square root of P square minus Q. So this is still the same solution. Yeah, I multiply with 1. Okay, but in the denominator, I have then, if I factor this out, P square plus square root, in the numerator, I have, if I factor this out, P square minus P square minus minus Q. So I have Q. So I get this guy here. So I get this guy here. I get Q divided by P plus the square root. Huh? So let's try this. Q divided by P plus the square root. This is also a solution. The solution actually looks quite similar than the previous one. But now the error is almost 0. It's machine precision. Okay, so this one works, the other does not work. A mathematician would actually believe both approaches work. Okay, so let's keep for illustration in the code the wrong solution and move to the next subject. Okay, so actually this is a quite nice example, yeah, where you have to be aware of this rounding error. Okay, so the reason is that we are rounding from an area which has a large rounding error. We have an arithmetic operation to an area which has a small rounding area error and some error propagation. So for the last few minutes, I like to go to, and maybe already reach into our next chapter, the Monte Carlo method. And actually in the Monte Carlo method, we will calculate expectations of random variables . Okay, and if you think in discretized sample spaces and your probability measure is uniform, then actually calculating the expectation is just calculate the average using uniform distribution, which is just take the sum of all values and divide by the number of values. So here below, I have a small code. I have a small class, which actually represents a random variable. In this random variable, here I have an array, which has all the different values. And if I like to have a function which calculates the average, I'm doing a very naive approach. I calculate the sum by initializing the variable sum to zero. Then I loop over all values, add each value to the sum, and then I divide by the number of values, which is actually the length of this array. Okay, so this is actually a standard code. Everybody would calculate the average this way. Yeah, and let's have a small example where we calculate the average of, say, so let's have a small example where we calculate the average of 10 million values all being the same, say 0.1. So actually, if I sum up 10 million times 0.1, I get 1 million. The sum is 1 million divided by 10 million is 0.1. So I would expect 0.1. Let's try this example. So let's go here. So I have a value. This value is 0.1. And I have some integer, which is number of values, and this should be 10 million. Okay. And then I have the sum. Calculated in this function. Okay, and then I like to print this value. Okay, let's calculate. Our task was to calculate the average. The average is, let's say the average is the sum divided by the number of values. Okay, and then I like to print this average. Okay, so and now he complains that he does not know such a function, so let's implement this function here. Let's implement this method. And I just implement what we just had. I initialize a variable called sum. Then I loop over all possible values. Here it's always the same value, but we are a bit stupid. We perform a loop over all values. So sum is equal to sum plus value, and we return the new value. Okay, so let's try this little example. Yeah. So maybe just try with 10. Yeah. What's wrong? Oh, return sum. Thanks. So let's try again. Okay, so we get actually 0.1 with a small rounding error. Okay, but that rounding error is just machine precision. I don't care. So let's try now with 10 million. Okay. So now we have a much larger rounding error. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Yeah. So we lost almost 7 digits. Yeah. So actually, we lost 2 × 10⁻⁶ in precision, 2 × 10⁻⁶ precision. And that's really frightening. Yeah. It's just because we did a sum over many values. And maybe you already know what's happening. There is a sum which is becoming larger and larger, and we are adding small numbers. Yeah. So the rounding error of this operation, sum plus value, is the relative error in the region of sum, which is in absolute terms a large one. And then in the end, we make it a small value again. Okay, so, and this is a really frightening thing. So you see that summation is actually something which we should take care of. And there is an algorithm which improves this in a very nice way. And this is my last thing for today. So maybe we have 10 minutes for this. Which is Kahan summation and which fixes the problem. Okay, so let's go back to the code. What is the problem? Sorry, but go back to the code. What is the problem? The problem is here. So let's write down our summation algorithm. Okay, so let's try this. I have to be a bit careful here. So what are we doing? Actually, we are creating a variable called sum in the beginning. Okay, and this is initialized to zero. And then we are looping over all values in our array. So now I use here from this, I use the array realizations, which provides the values. Okay, so actually I'm rewriting now this algorithm. So for all values, so for all indices, I from 0 to the length of our array. Okay, so for all these, get the value from the array. So the value is realizations. I, and then add this value to the sum. Okay, and that was our loop. Okay, so, and as I mentioned, the issue must be somewhere here. Assume, for example, the sum is already quite large. So say, for example, sum is 1. And value is small. Say, for example, value is epsilon. Then sum plus value, 1 plus epsilon, is equal to 1. So actually you see that in this case, he doesn't even sum up. He gets 1 again, and we lose the number value. Okay, so we lost the number value. So we somehow have to check for this. And how can we check for this? So let's define a variable called error. So I define a variable called error. So actually I initialize it here to 0, but it will be initialized now. Okay. So what is the error of this operation? Let's write this in a different color. So let's take queen because we are fixing something. So I have here double error. This is equal to zero. And here I define the error. So how do I get the error? So actually I check, is the sum which I get different from the previous sum? So I have to then introduce a new variable. So let's call this new sum. And this is a double. And for code style, you know, it's nice to have correct indentation. So actually this part here should be there. Okay, so now I have the new sum and the old sum, and I can check for the difference. So the difference is new sum minus sum. Actually, we should write camel notation. So sum gets a capital letter here, new sum. Okay. And you see in this example here, yeah, in our example of sum is one, value is epsilon, then the new sum will be also one. So one minus one is zero. And the error, I would expect that new sum minus sum is value. So I check for the difference to the value. So you see in the example, value would be epsilon, new sum would be one, sum would be one. So the error would be minus epsilon, which is the true error. Yeah, we would expect one plus epsilon. We have one, so the error is minus epsilon. Yeah, so we are by minus epsilon. Okay, so what can we do with this error? So what can we do with this error? So the value here, which we get from the array, is possible a small value, okay? And that was the issue, that value was a small value. So let's say this is new value, and the value which we then use in maybe I do it different. Let's call this variable here value. Yeah, and then let's introduce something which I call new value. Okay, so and new value should be value, but now value is a small number, so I can perform calculations with a higher machine precision on small numbers, but error is also a small number. So actually I can check the error and then I can put the error on the next value. Okay, so the new value should be value minus the error. Minus the error of the previous session of the previous loop, yeah? And then I replace here in the summation, I replace value by new value. Maybe I need a little bit more space here. So, and I replace it by new value. Okay, let's check the example again. If value is epsilon and the sum is one, Then new sum is 1 plus epsilon. It's by the rounding error, just 1. So new sum is 1. Then in the next step, error is minus epsilon. Okay, we have the error. So let's now go to the loop for the next iteration. Value is maybe again a small number, say epsilon. But now value minus the error was minus epsilon. So value minus the error is minus, minus is plus. Epsilon plus epsilon is 2 epsilon. So now the new sum is sum plus 2 epsilon. And suddenly the value which we add is large enough. So he can put something from the error into the new sum. Okay, this algorithm is called Kahan summation. Actually, this guy Kahan is the guy who worked on the definition of IEEE 754. And there are a lot of nice papers and stuff like this. And Kahan summation is actually fixing this rounding error issue we had in the sum. So this is how the algorithm looks like. So I do it a little bit different here. Yeah. So I'm not introducing the new value. Yeah. But you see the changes are that we check for some error here. Okay. And we apply the previous error to the next value. Okay, so two lines and this problem is fixed. Okay, so since we started 5 minutes later, let me finish this. So let's repeat now the summation with Kahan summation. So classical summation average is equal to this, yeah? So this is the output of the experiment with the classical summation. And now let's do the Kahan summation. So get sum of values Kahan from this. So let's get the average by dividing the sum with the value. And let's print the result with Kahan. And he tells me he does not know such a function. So let's create this method here. So this is sum of values Kahan. So I'm a bit lazy. I just copy the old classical algorithm here. And I've performed the modification which we just had. Yeah? So this here is the new sum. And then I define the error. The error is new sum minus value. And then I create a new value, and this new value actually should be the value corrected by the error. So, and use this new value in your summation. Okay, so I just realize that here we also have to use new value. Yeah, so here we also have to use, of course, new value because we want to check that the new value was correctly added to the sum. Okay. So I hope I have implemented this correctly. So this is already defined here. So let's check. I forgot I have to define sum equal new sum. So this is, there's a mistake. What's the mistake? Hey guys, help me. What's the mistake? I'm outputting not the average, I'm outputting the sum. Okay, so it's just a printout error. Okay, and let's go back to the slides. Did I do this assignment of the sum equals new sum? No, I also have to do this here. Yeah? So when we have calculated the new sum, yeah, then at the end of the loop, of course, we have to say that now sum is our new sum. Yeah, so this part here is just that instead of sum is equal to sum plus value, I have to remember what is the new sum and the old sum. I have to remember it, so I introduce new sum. And if I have new sum, then I can check for the error. And when I have checked for the error, then I can set the next iteration sum to the new sum. Okay, and you see from our little experiments here that this way of doing the summation fixes the error. Actually, a very nice thing, it's even better in the example with just 10. Yeah. So if you have just 10 here, you already have a very small error in the classical summation, and you have no error in the Kahan summation. And this is really, really a very good example, yeah? So summing up 10 values creates an error, and this algorithm avoids it. So let's conclude the session. This is the algorithm we have just discussed, and there's a theorem. Yeah, so maybe I leave this now for reading. You can actually prove the error propagation for both the classical summation. And you see that for the classical summation, the sum has some error which is becoming larger depending on the numbers of values you sum. Okay, the more values you sum, the larger becomes the error. It is approximately n times epsilon. So in our example, it was n times epsilon, n was 10 million, yeah? And you saw that we lost approximately 7 digits, yeah? So which is related to the n. And for the Kahan summation, actually, the error is, well, if you look at this here, you have the error. Being a multiplication, assume this error is always the same, then move it out of the sum. The error is just 2 times epsilon. Yeah, so it stays epsilon. Okay, so that was it for today. This is the exercise which we just did. So this is a code session, suggestion for a code session. Find the machine precision. We did this. Look at the maximum possible value. We did this. Explore plus and minus 0. We did this. Solve a quadratic equation. Yes, and calculate the average of some values. So we also did these. I will check in the code into GitHub so you can play a little bit around. And we also have an exercise that you should work on this. I believe now the exercise should be fine. So it's just to get you started with working a little bit on code. Yeah. But if you have questions, just write us an email. So, and last thing is thank you. And here in the script, you find a reference on this article here, what every computer scientist should know about floating point arithmetic. And maybe you can read this article. Yeah, I provide the link here. You find some of the examples of this lecture inside there, but you also find other ones. Yeah, for example, here's the example with the quadratic equation. Yeah, and a discussion on this, and so on. So, okay, that's it.